So in previous session, we have discussed about probability and its related aspects with respect to artificial intelligence, how it can be applied in various areas of AI. And also we have seen one important application or important concept of probability about Bayes' theorem. Let's now move ahead with the next concept of your chapter 3, that is Bayesian belief network, which is a very, very important algorithm or a concept with respect to your probability for decision making. So talking about your Bayesian belief network, as the name says, it is, the name is a Bayesian model, which is basically relies on your Bayes' theorem only. So it is a key computer technology for dealing with probabilistic events and to solve a problem which has uncertainty. So we are dealing with the concept of uncertainty as part of your chapter 3. So whenever you are having some uncertainties in your problem solving, we actually come across a probability, and in probabilistic reasoning or probabilistic theory, we come across an important concept called as Bayesian belief network, or it's also called as your Bayes network. It has many different names. So a Bayesian network is a probabilistic graphical model which represents a set of variables and their conditional dependence using a directed acyclic graph. So you have already learned about this concept called as what is a cyclic graph and what is a directed acyclic graph. So basically a cyclic means it forms a cycle, and acyclic means it does not lead to a cycle at the end of a given network. So it will be having a proper directions in the given network. That's why it's called as directed acyclic graph. Okay. So basically, when I talk about a Bayesian belief network, it is a probabilistic model which represents variables and conditional dependencies using directed acyclic graph. We also call it as DAG. Okay. One second. So it is also called as Bayes network, belief network, decision network, or Bayesian model. So the name itself says that it is a completely relied on your Bayes theorem. So Bayesian networks are probabilistic because these networks are built from a probability distribution and also uses probability theory for prediction. So basically, whenever you are having a decision making with respect to your intelligent machine or any other model, the final goal is to predict the next step. So if you want to do that, whenever you are having some uncertainties, we actually come across this model called as Bayesian belief network model. So in real world applications, there are many real world applications which are probabilistic in nature, and to represent the relationship between those multiple happening events, we actually use your Bayesian network in different areas. Like we use Bayesian network for prediction, the last point says that it has many applications, like in the area of prediction, for anomaly detection, whether somebody intruder is happening in your network. That's what we call anomalies, means some disturbances in your network, some diagnostics, automated insight, reasoning, which is the current concept what we are talking about, probabilistic reasoning, time series prediction, decision making under uncertainty. The last point says that decision making under uncertainty, which is the concept we are discussing as part of our syllabus. That is, whenever you are having some uncertainties, if you want to make a proper decision, we actually use your Bayesian belief network. Okay, yeah. So as I said, a Bayesian belief network is a directed acyclic graph. It can be used in many different ways. So there are two important parts, or we segregate into two important parts. Like directed acyclic graph is one way we represent your Bayesian network. And next one is table of conditional probabilities. So you'll be drawing a conditional probabilities table, and thus you'll be deriving the result, like how to get some decision making process using your Bayesian belief network. So here you can see A is one node, B, C, and D are the other nodes. So you'll be having some nodes, some directions. As I said, here it is called as arc, which is directing to some points. So here you can see this is a closed path, but this doesn't form a cycle here. You can see A is a parent for D and B. And similarly, D and B are parents of C. This is the terminology what we follow using your Bayesian belief network. Thus, we form a network. And finally, we make some decisions using your Bayesian belief network. Okay, yeah. The generalized form of Bayesian network that represents and solves decision problems under certain knowledge is known as influence diagram. So basically, we call the same diagram also as influence diagram. Okay, so I hope we are now aware of what actually is the Bayesian belief network and why we are using it in different areas of AI. It can be machine learning, because if you want to make some proper decision whenever you are having some uncertainty, we actually use your Bayesian network. Okay, yeah. So talking about the influence diagram, whatever we have seen now, each node corresponds to some random variables, and a variable can be continuous or discrete. So here each node, as I said, A is one node, B is other node, C is one node, and D is one node. Each node corresponds to one random variable, and a variable can be continuous or it can be discrete. So here you can see indicated here arrow mark. It is called as arc, or we call it as an arrow. And it's a directed arrow, which represents the causal relationship or conditional probabilities between two random variables. Here you can see an arrow pointed between A and D. As I said, A is a parent and D is a child. So these two have some relationship among them, and that can be found out, that can be identified using probabilistic random variables. And these directed links or arrows connect the pair of nodes in the given graph. So according to the inputs given, so this is a small architecture of the Bayesian belief network. But according to the given problem, the architecture may vary, and it will finally lead to some decisions. Yeah. So talking about this, detailed about this diagram. So that in the diagram, A, B, C, D are random variables represented by the nodes of the network graph. And if you are considering node B, which is connected with node A, so here you can see B connected to A, and D is also connected to A by directed arrow, then node A is called the parent of node B. As I said, A is the parent of D and B, and D and B are the parents of C. That's how we use the terminology using your directed acyclic graph. Node C is independent of node A. So you can see C is nowhere related to A. That's why it is a independent value here. So the Bayesian network graph does not contain any cyclic graph. Hence, it is called as directed acyclic graph, as is mentioned earlier. So you can see this is a closed graph, but it is not forming a cycle. So the decision will be ending up at C, and it will not revert back to A. That's why it is not a cyclic graph. It is called as directed acyclic graph. Okay. Yeah. So yeah, the Bayesian belief network or the Bayesian network has mainly two components. That is a causal component and actual numbers. So if you want to learn about your Bayesian belief network, so it has some conditional probability. As I said, it is linked to some parent and child. If I say here P of Xi with respect to parent of Xi, which determines the effect of parent on that node. So as I said, your Xi indicates A, or it can be B, and X of, parent of X of I is the A. So parent here is the higher node, and the next elements are the child. So yeah, Bayesian network is based on joint probability distribution and conditional probability. One second. Yeah, so as I said, Bayesian belief network will be basically linked to two things. That is, it will be, we need to compute joint probability distribution, and also we need to compute conditional probability if you want to work with your Bayesian network. So what actually is joint probability distribution? Suppose if we have variables X1, X2, X3, and so on, or some random variables which we are having, then the probabilities of different combinations of x1, x2, x3, so on, are known as joint probability distribution. So you'll be having some random variables, some x1, x2, it can be a number of variables. If you want to find the probability of different combination, like x1 with x2, x1 with x3, this is called as your joint probability distribution. So whenever you are having some parameters given, the values or variables given, you need to understand them and you need to find the compute the joint probability distribution, and then accordingly you need to compute your go for your Bayesian belief network. So you can see here probabilities of x1, x2, so on, it can be written as the following way in terms of joint probability distribution. So when I talk about joint probability distribution, you can see x1 computed with respect to x2, x3, so on, and x2 computed with the other functions. So likewise, you can see x1 with x2, x2 with x3, so on. You can see this is the final formula. What you can see, x1 with x2, x2 with x3, xn with xn, and also you can see at the end p of xn. So in general, for each variable xi, we can write the equation as given here. Okay, this is the equation for computing your joint probability distribution. Okay, yeah. So let's now take an example and understand how Bayesian network actually functions. What is the way of solving a Bayesian network problem? So a Bayesian belief network or Bayesian network provides a simple way of applying Bayes theorem to complex problems. So it's nothing more, guys. We are trying to apply your Bayes theorem for a much complex problem, and we call it as a Bayesian network. Okay, yeah. Let's understand the Bayesian network through an example. So, yeah. So this example is a very common example which is being discussed whenever we talk about your Bayesian belief network. So it talks about some burglary or some robbery at a home, and somebody who is at office, they want to identify. Whenever something bad is happening at their home, or there's a burglary at their home, and they want to catch the person, or they can want to catch the thief. So for that, you can see Harry is one person installed a new burglar alarm at his home to detect burglary. So burglary here is nothing but a theft at home. The alarm reliably responds at detecting a burglary, but also responds for the minor earthquakes. It not only responds for the burglary at home, due to some small earthquakes also, it may cause some disturbance and alarm may make some sound. So now, yeah, Harry has two neighbors, David and Sophia. These are the two neighbors he has used for saying if there's any problem or some alarm, they need to give him a call. Who have taken responsibility to inform Harry at work when they hear the alarm, because alarm will happen at home, and because Harry is not at home, he want to get the response from his neighbors that there is some alarm at your home, and it may be due to some burglary. So David always calls Harry when he hears the alarm. But sometimes he got confused with the phone ringing and calls at that time too. So it's not only it's the problem because David's phone ring also is having the same tune. There is a probability of having that. That's why because whenever the phone rings, he may assume that this may be because of the alarm, and he calls Harry. So think David and Sophia are the intelligent agents here, guys. So because we're talking about AI, so assume that because you are working at an office and you have appointed two intelligent machines, assume David and Sophia are the two intelligent machines here. It should give you a call whenever there is an alarm sound. Okay, think it in this aspect, and accordingly you'll be getting your understanding of the problem. So on the other hand, Sophia likes to listen to high music. So sometimes she misses to hear the alarm because she might be using your earphones and she might be busy with her music. Even though alarm has rang, she might not call Harry. So these are some of the possibilities which may happen, and it may lead to some uncertainty. So Harry is not aware that Sophia is listening to music, and he will be assuming that Yeah, Sophia will be calling me if there is any burglary. But because Sophia is not active here, she's listening to some music, she might not call Harry, and it may lead to some burglary. And whatever the efforts kept by Harry in identifying the burglar or thief is lost. So here we would like to compute the probability of burglary alarm. Yeah. So the question is, calculate the probability that alarm has sounded, but there is neither a burglary nor an earthquake occurred. Because there are some probabilities which may happen, and they may give some wrong report. David and Sophia both called the Harry, even though there was no burglary and there was no earthquake. What is the probability of getting this? So now, if you want to solve this, you need to understand it in terms of this given graph. So here, the main parameter is alarm, whether alarm has rang or not. And we are having two conditions. That is, it may be due to burglary, which is indicated using your B. B indicates burglary, and E indicates your earthquake. And what is the probability that David calls Harry? And what is the probability that Sophia calls Harry? So initially, we need to construct a directed acyclic graph as shown in the image here. And next, as I said, you need to compute joint probability and conditional probability values. Okay, yeah, let's talk about that later. Now let's try to understand the problem and how we need to solve that. So the Bayesian network for the above problem is given below. The network structure is shown that burglary and earthquake is the parent node. So as I said here, burglary and earthquake are the parent nodes for alarm. Okay, yeah. And directly affecting the probability of alarms going off. But David and Sophia's call depend on alarm probability. That's why I can say here, David and Sophia are the childs of this alarm. They only respond according to the alarm sound. Okay, yeah. Then it, even whenever you're answering for examination, you need to mention your answers in this point wise. That's why we have listed the point wise explanation of your given problem. You need to construct a graph, and according to that graph, you need to give your answer. The network is representing that our assumptions do not directly perceive the burglary and also do not notice the minor earthquake. And then by looking into this diagram, we cannot directly say whether burglary happened or not, or we cannot directly say whether earthquake happened or not. That's the reason we need to go for your calculations. The conditional distributions for each node are given as conditional probabilities table. So we need to construct a conditional probability table. As you can see here, you are having two different things here. The burglary might be true is 0.002. On the left side, you can see true and false values of burglary and earthquake. These are the observed values. This can be taken randomly by the user. So here we are not computing these values. That burglary happened is 0.002. These are the observed values which will be given in your question. In examination point of view, these questions will be given what are the observed values. And considering these observed values, you need to compute your conditional probability table. Whatever you can see here, this is the conditional probability table which is being calculated. I'll be showing that later. Let's try to understand the concept first, and then we'll be coming to your problem solving. So as I said, the observed probability values for burglary and earthquake components are here. So what is the chance of probability of B, P of B is equal to true? That is 0.002, which is the probability of burglary. So P of B is equal to false, 0.998, which is the probability of no burglary. These are the observed probability values which will be given in a question for problem solving. Okay, yeah. So in a conditional probability table, a Boolean variable with k Boolean parents combined contains 2 power k probabilities. Hence, if there are 2 parents, then we will be having 4 probability values. That's the reason you can see here, because you are having two parents B and E, we have got 4 conditional probability table values here. So B and E here are the parents. So 2 power 2 is again 4. That's why we are getting four conditional probability values. Okay, yeah. So now let's try coming to the naming convention. B indicates burglary, E indicates earthquake, A indicates alarm, D is David calls Harry, or S indicates Sophia calls Harry. So now we are trying to compute the joint probability distribution of the given values according to this equation. Okay, so this is the equation to compute your joint probabilities in for a given question. That is P of D, that is David and Sophia calls with respect to A, B and E. You can see the descending order from D to E. Okay, and next we are calculating the individual probabilities, that P of D with Sophia calls or alarm, burglary and earthquake, into P of again individual probabilities. That's how we are trying to compute each and every chance, and we'll be computing the joint probabilities. Okay, and finally we'll be getting a table like this. I'll be just showing you how to calculate this, which I have done using handwritten. I'll try to send you this table separately again. Yeah, so accordingly we'll be trying to get some observed probability values, and later we'll be trying to compute the values. And you can see the question will be asked like this: find the probability of P, probability of true with respect to false. Your negation again indicates false. So there will be different representation, guys. Don't worry about that. The question can be asked directly like this, or sometimes the question can be asked like this also. Find the probability of P of here P1 and P3 are David and Sophia. A, B and E are the same name conventions. So according to the conditional probabilities, you need to compute the values and form a table. And finally, you need to make a decision whether whatever that call Harry has got, whether it is how much percent it is correct. Here you can see what's the probability of alarm is ringing, and what is the probability of Sophia calling is true, that is 0.75, and 0.25 is false. Similarly, you can see what's the probability of David is true, 0.91. So that's how we should compute your Bayesian belief network, and finally you need to give your results. Okay, so that's it about your Bayesian belief network. So I'll be sending you a Word document calculation very clearly about how this can be done in your Google Classroom, in your notes. Don't worry about that. So try to understand the concept, like what has to be done. So here, these are the steps which we need to follow. Initially, we need to construct a graph indicating your direct acyclic graph and see that there is no cycle. And next, we need to take the observed values. Next, you need to compute, see how many parents are there. And according to your parents, you will be having your conditional probability table. And once you get your conditional probability table, you will be getting your separate decision-making process. Okay, yeah.